Welcome and thank you for taking the time to be here this afternoon. I'm Haley Posey and I'm the coordinator of digital publishing services at the library. We're thrilled to have SPARC's Open Education Director, Nicole Allen, here on campus to talk with us about open textbooks and open educational resources. Before we turn it over to Nicole, I just want to give a little bit of background about where we stand in this conversation on our campus locally. As many of you probably know, Gina Raimondo and the Rhode Island Office of Innovation created the Rhode Island Statewide Open Textbook Initiative in September of 2016. The initiative aims to reduce college costs by saving students $5 million over 5 years using openly licensed textbooks and OERs. In addition to Providence College, current participants include Rhode Island College, the University of Rhode Island, the Community College of Rhode Island, Bryant, Roger Williams, Brown, and others. So it's the majority of the higher education institutions in the state are now participating in the initiative. After Providence College committed to participating in the initiative, folks from the library here and the Center for Teaching Excellence came together around moving the initiative forward on our campus. Following the example of several other institutions, we sought support from the provost's office to create mini grants for faculty interested in replacing costly textbooks with open ones. The application process for the first round of mini grants is complete, and faculty recipients have been selected from education, chemistry and biochemistry, psychology, and finance. And the library will be working closely with those four faculty to rewrite their syllabi for instruction using OER in the fall of 2017. So clearly we're gaining steam around this topic, both locally and at the state level. But we'd like to provide additional information around the issue of open textbooks for folks who may not have been aware of the movement. So for that context, we turn to Nicole Allen, who's the Director of Open Education at the Scholarly Publishing and Academic Resources Coalition, or SPARC. In her current role, Nicole focuses on public policy and engaging the library community around open education. She's an internationally recognized expert and a leading voice in the movement for open education, and we're very pleased to welcome you today, Nicole. Thank you.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
I'm really excited to be here. I have traveled to about 200 universities since the start of my career to talk about these issues, and it's a pleasure to come to an institution that's actually close to home for me. So my job is based in Washington, D.C. with SPARC, but I actually live here in Providence. My partner's job is based out of Newport, and I was just thrilled when Governor Raimondo announced the Open Textbook Initiative, and you know, we had an opportunity to engage here in Rhode Island on these kind of initiatives, and you know, it's the kind of state where you can literally get every institution around the table. And when I went to my boss and said, you know, we're gonna partner with the Rhode Island Open Textbook Initiative and offer to do a talk or a workshop at every campus in the state, she was like, what? I was like, there are only 13. and there's nowhere you can't get within the state within an hour. So I think it's super cool though, because small states have the ability to innovate in a way that larger states don't. And I think it's really great to see the level of interest and enthusiasm at the campuses here. So I appreciate the invitation to come here and work with you guys and talk a little bit more about this issue. So as Haley said, my role here is going to be giving a little bit of context about textbook costs and open educational resources as a solution. For those of you familiar with the issue, this may be information you already know. But hopefully it can still be useful, as hearing somebody else talk about it is often useful in shaping the way that you talk about it. So I invite you to listen and critique and ask questions throughout the conversation as we go along if you're interested in certain areas or have questions. The slides that I have here, I have a lot of slides and I move quickly. They're citations and notes about each of the statistics and studies and programs that I'm going to mention in the slide deck. I'm sure we'll share that out, but I also tweeted it about 15 minutes ago. For those of you who are all over Twitter, you can get the link right now there.
Is there a way that we can get it if we don't tweet?
Yes, I'm sure that we'll distribute it afterwards. but if you want it right now, that's where you go.
We're not going to be tweeting, we're going to be listening to you.
Oh, I don't know. It's another way of participation, but I appreciate your full attention. Okay, so SPARC is a coalition of academic and research libraries across the US and Canada, and we have a network across the world. We work on opening up the way that we share information in research and education. You know, we've seen how the internet and access to technology has changed the world we live in, and for the better, you know, giving us access to information, increasing the efficiency with it, which we share information. And yet, in higher education and in research, we're not fully taking advantage of it, because so much of the knowledge that we produce is published in journals that are expensive to access and textbooks that are outrageously expensive and difficult to localize and customize. You know, education isn't one size fits all. And we believe in changing policies and practices to help achieve that vision, and that's what SPARC works on, and specifically my role in working on open educational resources hopes to achieve. And I'll also mention that I am the product of a liberal arts education. I went to the University of Puget Sound in Tacoma, Washington, which is about the same size as PC. So I understand the value of attending a small private college and the unique kind of education that you can get here. I also understand the cost that students face coming here, and that, you know, even though the biggest costs are around tuition and room and board, there are other expenses that students face that can have an impact on their ability to afford an education. So, you know, when we look at the various costs students face, you know, tuition fees, room and board, transportation, generally the aid that students receive in order to be able to afford college, I mean, we all know that the student debt crisis is just out of control. Students have to take on enormous amounts of debt in order to get an education, which is, you know, okay if they can pay back that investment and get a good job, but they can't always. And student aid doesn't always extend to all of the expenses, and books and supplies is often one of the last expenses that students need to pay, often, you know, needing to put it on credit cards or pay it out of pocket. So the psychological impact of textbook costs is still really high. And if you look at that in the context of student budgets, you know, the bottom is a private nonprofit four-year textbook. Prices are, you know, a tiny little slice at the end. But books and supplies, the average annual student budget is still $1,200, which, you know, is a lot of money to an individual who maybe doesn't have access to family funds or who has to work to cover the cost of their education. You know, how many shifts do you need to work to afford your economics textbook? And often students see these in those terms. And what it ends up being is the straw that breaks the camel's back, one of the last expenses. And that's a challenge because textbooks are, you know, critical to education. Students need access to the course materials that they've been assigned. And, you know, I think all of us are probably familiar with this problem, but I just want to give you one illustration, an example of the kind of textbook prices that students are facing right now. So you may not be able to see this Principles of Economics by Gregory Mankiw, you know, kind of the canonical economics textbook. Anybody who can't read the board, want to guess how much this book costs to buy in as a print book? Or can you all read the board? Okay, yeah, so I'm usually counting on people who are farther away. Or bad eyes, I don't know. So $406, Principles of Economics. Okay, so let's just stop and think about that for a minute. Like, the economic principles that explain why it's possible to charge $400 for an economics textbook are described in this book, but good luck learning them without being able to buy the book. And I've known economics instructors who actually use their textbook, the textbook they've assigned, when they're talking about things like price elasticity and concepts that illustrate, you know, why prices can be so high. So that's just crazy. $400 for intro economics textbook where, you know, obviously pedagogical styles change and, you know, this book is written by, you know, an expert in the field. But, you know, the material of intro economics is well established. You know, there's not unique information in there. $400. Okay. So, but here's the thing. If you want to get a digital copy of this book, $126. So cheaper, right? Less than $400. So that's good. But the thing is that you don't know until you click this and put it in your cart that it's actually this. One term, 6 months, instant access. And that's it. So it disappears after 6 months. And for those of you who know principles of economics, it's usually broken up into two semesters, macro and micro. So what you're actually going to end up paying is more like $260. I think that's right, approximately. So you're actually not saving that much money when it comes down to it. And you don't have anything to keep at the end of the semester. And you know, when we think about what it's like for students to experience it, it's kind of like this, like Men in Black, where they take out the little thing and zap your memory. It's like, you better read this book fast because we're gonna zap it away. And think of the message that sends to students. Like, you know, this material is valuable for you to have access now, but it's not valuable enough for you to keep. And this is the kind of model that the publishing industry is pushing us towards. And, you know, I know we have a lot of librarians in the room, and you all know that, you know, the digital models that are out there aren't a solution in the sense that they hold over a lot of the limitations of the print format, such as purchasing a seat license for a book. So even though the digital format allows you basically infinite number of copies, there are artificial limits on how many people can view it at one time because the publishing industry needs to do that in order to preserve their traditional business models. So let's talk a minute about the publishing industry. So first of all, the textbook market, and again, you would know this if you could afford that $400 economics textbook. So the textbook market doesn't work like a normal consumer market. Students are basically captives. Because they don't get to choose what product they buy. They choose, you know, what courses they take and what professors they work with and what institution they attend, but they don't choose their textbook. And of course, that's the way it needs to work because professors are the people who know, you know, their subject and what their students need to learn. So, you know, we're not arguing that shouldn't work that way, but what it does is it creates the system where publishers can basically raise prices and students can do nothing about it because they need to buy that particular textbook in order to take the course. Of course, that isn't always what ends up happening these days, but we'll talk about that in a second. So the textbook market, so economists refer to this as an inelastic market. So there's also the fact that the textbook industry is controlled by 5 major publishers. The vast majority of the market, which reduces competition and creates extremely high barriers to entry for innovation. Since, you know, professors are used to receiving sample copies of textbooks from you know, a set of basically 5 companies, it's kind of created this groove where that's the way it works, and it's hard for innovators to break into that market. And then there's also kind of weird dynamics going on where you're going to hear a lot of different things in the media. So, you know, you're obviously hearing that textbook prices are rising out of control. You know, 82% textbook prices have increased over 80% over the last decade. So they've more than doubled since I started college. And I remember my first semester, I bought a math textbook for $120. But you're hearing kind of mixed messages from, especially from the bookstore and publishing industry, that student spending is going down. So there's no question, nobody debates that prices have gone up. But student spending is starting to go down. And, you know, there are a number of studies that show that, and you know, it seems correct. So how can both of those things be happening? Prices going up, student spending going down. So part of it is absolutely that there are more ways for students to save than there ever have been. Even, you know, I started college in 2003. There wasn't the option to rent textbooks. Now, most bookstores offer that. You can do it online very easily and save a whole bunch of money. You can buy and sell used books. And, you know, bookstores are offering a lot of ways to save money on textbooks. And, you know, after your first semester as a freshman, you quickly learn. But the problem also is that there are a lot of students who just aren't buying the textbooks because they're too expensive. So they're sharing copies with friends, they're, you know, downloading illicit copies from the internet, they're making photocopies of chapters, they're buying, you know, international editions intended for India or China. That you know, have basically the same content, but are you know, printed in paperback or whatever, and it's starting to show up in studies. So there have been a number of studies over the past few years that have shown that a significant proportion of students now say that they don't buy all their required books because of costs. This is one. Two out of every three, 65%, say that they have skipped buying a textbook because the cost is too high. And the really alarming thing about this is that out of these students, those two out of three students, the vast majority of those students say that they have done it even knowing that it could harm their grade in a class. So, you know, it may seem small in the context of the overall cost of education, but it is that straw that breaks the camel's back. And it has a negative impact on student learning. At some institutions, it also has an impact on speed to graduation and what courses they take. You know, one in two students say that they have taken fewer courses due to the cost of textbooks. You know, a lot of students will say that they've dropped out of a course or failed a course because they haven't bought the textbook. And this one is one that I always like to mention to faculty because it's really important. A recent study found that less than half of the students in any given class will actually have the current edition of the textbook. So the book that you as a faculty member told your students is, you know, the exact edition and the exact title that they're supposed to have. Less than half of your students will actually have that book. And whether it's right or wrong, it is. And at the end of the day, students can't learn from materials that they can't afford. So it brings us to this situation where we have a problem, and we need solutions to that problem. And, you know, we've been talking about this issue of textbook prices for more than a decade. And the publishing industry, while it's taken steps, it hasn't come up with a model that could work. And in today's world, we know we can do better. And that's where this idea of open education comes into play. And the broader term of open education refers to breaking down barriers to ensure that we take advantage of all of the ways we can educate in today's world. You know, whether it's increasing the ability of people to take classes by putting a camera on a professor and sharing video lectures with the entire world, whether it's you know, broadening the resources that are shared with the world, lowering barriers for students with disabilities, increasing the ability for students to participate in the classroom and help co-create part of their education. So this is a broad term with lots of different applications and lots of exciting applications. But at its core, there's this idea of open educational resources, which are actually the content that capture knowledge. And you can use that in a lot of different ways, in addition to using it the way that we use course materials right now, like textbooks. So this term, open educational resources, how many of you are familiar with this? Who wants to define it? So you all know what educational resources are, you know, whether it's a textbook or a video lecture, assessment, you know, any kind of tool that can be used for education. We will abbreviate it OER. The thing that sets these resources apart is open, this idea of openness. And when we say open, we mean something very, very specific. So first, It's free, meaning free of cost and free of barriers to access. So, you know, not behind a password protected website, and then, you know, you don't have to pay to get access to it in itself. You know, there are ways to add value and build business models around that, but the core content is free. And the second part is the idea of reuse rights, permissions to use the material. And that means an open license granting permission, or if the resource is already in the public domain, you already have that permission. And we define the reuse rights that set open educational resources aside from free educational resources or digital educational resources. You know, you can go on the web and find a whole bunch of free content. But what's different about open content is that you can do these five things. We call them the five R's. So the right to retain, meaning to keep and control a copy of the resource. So no Men in Black moment after you've accessed the resource. You know, students can keep, you know, entire library of their educational resources on a thumb drive for their entire lives if they wish. The right to reuse, meaning to take a resource and use it in any context you want, whether it's the context it was intended for. I think, you know, one great example of that is all of the photos that are published by NASA and made available in the public domain. Those frequently find their way into textbooks. And, you know, NASA didn't create them for that purpose, but that's a really great way to make use of the investment that, our government makes in NASA. So the right to revise, meaning to take a copy of the resource and actually edit it, localize it. You know, education isn't one size fits all. Every student and professor is unique, and it creates the opportunity to actually change content to fit the needs of the students. You know, I've never met a professor who said that, you know, the textbook I'm using is the perfect textbook. There's always something. And the idea of revising is the ability to go in and change it. And that can be as simple as, you know, adding in images or examples, swapping them out. Like I know in math problems, one of my favorite examples is in a word problem that talks about the length of a bridge. You know, I grew up outside New York City, and, you know, we always had things like the George Washington Bridge and things that were around us because it's a large area. But what if that said the Pell Bridge? You know, students, when they're learning math, it's important to be able to visualize. And providing examples that are relevant to the world around them really helps with that. So remixing, this idea is about taking multiple resources and mixing them together to create something new. So adding videos into a text-based resource, or taking two openly licensed textbooks and mixing up the chapters to create a new one. And then finally, the idea of redistributing. So the right, legal right to take a resource or any resource you've derived from that resource and share it with anyone you want, however you want. So whether that's printing out copies, whether it's posting it online in the LMS, sharing it with students on flash drive, redistribute. So those are the five R's. The official definition of open educational resources is this. It's kind of long and wonky, but teaching, learning, and research resources that either reside in the public domain or have been released under an intellectual property license that permits their free use and repurposing by others. The idea of permissions and free use and repurposing when you don't already have that permission, so if a resource isn't already in the public domain, there's a system of licensing that you can use to actually grant that permission. Under US copyright law, you automatically own the copyright of works that you create, whether you want those rights or not. And people have to legally ask you permission to use those resources, whether you want them to or not. And this system of open licensing gives you as a creator the ability to grant permission in advance to the public to be able to use your resource in all of the ways that we just talked about with the five R's. And that's what Creative Commons licenses are. Most open educational resources use one of these licenses. And I'm sure that, you know, those of you that are familiar with you know, a lot of resources on the web have seen this before. YouTube lets users use that. I think the video of this presentation is going to be uploaded under a Creative Commons license. Wikipedia is under one of these licenses. Flickr, a ton of resources there under these licenses. Okay, so now that we have the definitional stuff out of the way, I want to give you a quick tour of what's going on in the OER world, like who's creating these resources, what kind of business models they have behind them, and how that's playing out in terms of impacts. So first of all, I just want to point you to a great resource. It's called the OER World Map. They are collecting stories and examples of projects that are developing OER and using OER. And if any of you have good examples from here, I encourage you to add them so other people can discover it. So I think, oh, do you want to take a picture of that?
Yes, sure. Together. Thank you.
All right. Are you going to do a selfie?
I mean, I know that, yeah, exactly.
okay. So most of you have probably heard of this, MIT's Open Courseware Program. It was kind of the first big open education program that was announced. The idea behind it was, you know, at MIT, they, you know, produce a vast amount of high-quality educational resources. Their scholars are some of the top scholars in the world, but they only ever reached a couple thousand students a year. The idea behind MIT Open Courseware was to work with the professors who wanted to share their resources and give them a platform to do so. So to post, you know, whatever materials, their lecture notes, you know, assignments, readings if they have them, and make those available to the world. And since then, over 200 million people have used them. And what's really cool, because they made them open, there have been people all around the world that have translated many of these resources into 6 different languages. And another more than 50 million people have used those translations. So it's something that could never have happened if the resources were simply posted online. By giving people permission to use them, MIT can actually benefit from having great translations of the resources that they have for the many students who come to MIT who aren't native English speakers. Yes?
So it's the materials themselves that are available. So you have access to the syllabus, or is it simply, so it's everything, the syllabus, the assignments?
It depends.
For independent study, for example, or?
Yeah, so it depends. For this particular program, MIT made it voluntary for faculty, which, you know, it would. And it depends what resources are available for which course. Some have everything, including the textbooks. Some have, you know, just a syllabus and, you know, a few resources, because, you know, the professor can only share resources that they have the right to legally share. But, you know, it's great, and I was actually just in South Africa in December, and talked to a student there who had actually used resources from this in her own studies. So, you know, it's a great way to expand the impact of the education an institution offers. So there are actually over 200 institutions across the world that have created programs like this. It's not something that every campus wants to do, but the ones that have greatly expanded the amount of resources that are available. So there are also a number of online repositories that collect open educational resources. And this is one example, oercommons.org. It's one of the largest. They have hundreds of thousands of resources from, you know, every grade level, every type of subject area. And all types of resources, too, from textbooks to videos to assessments. And some of them are actually aligned to state standards for K-12 teachers, which can be really useful. Anybody can go here and post resources and download them and search them and share them. So there are also publishing efforts, and this example, OpenStax, is probably the most prominent and successful. So this is a nonprofit publisher that operates kind of like a startup. It's based at Rice University, and they're publishing open textbooks for the highest enrollment courses, so your Calc 101, Bio 101, the courses with the $400 textbook. And I actually have here their economics textbook, which I'm happy to pass around. So their model is to distribute the books. They're free online for anybody to read. They're in a platform where faculty can actually customize them, remove chapters. So, you know, in principles of economics, you're probably not going to cover all of this. The instructor can actually remove the stuff they're not going to cover, add in stuff that they want to cover that's not in here. So this, anyone want to guess how much this costs? Print book? Yeah. Something like that, 35. Full color. So And that's one of the great things about open, is that it's not an either or. It's not the $136 digital access that's going to expire after 6 months, or a $400 textbook, or you know, something you've shared with your roommate. It's whatever the student wants and needs. They can print out parts if they need to print them out. They can, you know, read it on their smartphone, on the bus, on the way to school. They can buy a low-cost print copy if that's what they want. It creates options, which I think is really the way to get around this idea of the captive market. And the business model of this organization is to partner with outside companies that produce products of value around these resources, such as homework software, tutoring services, assessment services that actually, you know, add value on top of the content. And students pay for that, but they're not paying for the core content, which is, you know, common knowledge and well-established, and enables the professor to actually create a textbook that fully meets the needs of their course. So there are also a number of other publishing operations out there. Open Book Publishers in the UK is another example. And there are a couple of for-profit ones here in the US. There's also, just to mention, the whole movement for open access publishing in research. There are a number of publishers, most notably PLOS, that publish open access journals under a Creative Commons license. And all of their content is available to be used for educational resources. And I actually know for a fact that some of the open textbook publishing efforts have taken images and charts and examples out of research articles and included them in their educational resources. And what could be better, right? That cutting edge research is actually feeding directly into our educational resources. And that's not possible if we're publishing our research behind paywalls without the right to fully use it. There are efforts like the Open Learning Initiative at Carnegie Mellon University to develop full courses that are self-guided, and students can actually take the course and take assessments as they go. And because the content is open, it can adapt the course as the student goes along to actually better meet the needs of the student. Open Learning Initiative has published over 20 courses that students can actually go and use right now. You can assign it as part of a course, but students can also use it just as extra help to supplement their own learning. And then finally, I just want to mention that government has actually seen the value in open educational resources. A few years ago, the Department of Labor launched a program with one of possibly the most ridiculous acronyms you will ever encounter. It is the TAACCCT program, Trade Adjustment Assistance Community College and Career Training Grants Program. Anyway, it was a $2 billion investment in workforce training programs. And rather than giving a bunch of grants to a bunch of colleges to develop workforce training programs that only they would use, they required that the colleges who took the grants to release the resources they created under an open license so everybody else can benefit from them too. And this is the website where all of those resources are being posted. The first round of grants is already up there. And there's actually, I was talking with an ally in the US State Department the other day, and there's actually a program that USAID, the US aid organization, helped run or partnered with in Mexico that took a bunch of the resources developed through this program from Washington and Arizona in aerospace and clean energy and translated it into Spanish and adapted it for their local program in Mexico, and did so at you know, a fraction of the cost, a program that the US government would have funded if they hadn't had access to these resources. And rather starting with scratch, they could translate them and make them locally relevant. And then what they did is actually share that back. So in Arizona, the colleges there have a lot of native Spanish speakers going to college. So it can actually help to share resources because you get benefit back. And we as taxpayers, I mean, we're paying for this stuff. We should have the right to use it. Okay, I want to share just a couple of examples of the kind of impacts that OER can have. So I've talked about you know, some examples of how resources are being created, so how they're being used, and what that means for the people using them. So we were saying before that the state of Rhode Island is challenged to save students $5 million over 5 years. This one professor saved his students $1 million alone. And when you think about the kind of scale that can be achieved, you know, if you're assigning a $200 textbook in a course that, you know, he's at a large institution where they have 100 student classes, that adds up really, really quickly. So, you know, 100 student course, $200 textbook, that's $200,000 potentially saved if you, you know, adjust it for the number of students that actually buy the textbook, probably less, but it can add up really quickly. And that's real money that has an impact on students' lives. And I think that, you know, no step in this direction is too small. These two authors, Barbara Olasky and Susan Dean from California, have written an open textbook. So they had originally written a traditional textbook that, you know, they sold, you know, a few thousand copies every year and got a few thousand dollars in royalties every year. But when the publisher put it out of print, they decided to get the copyright back and update it and release it as an open textbook. And now millions of students have used this book now, or millions of people have accessed this book all over the world. Because they made it open. And the two authors actually received an award for the textbook that they likely never would have, you know, even been considered for if they hadn't done something different. The world didn't need another statistics textbook, but it did need an open one. And what they found is actually instructors who use this have added resources to it, written chapters that weren't originally included that you can optionally add, written test banks and resources that go with the textbook and shared those. So it's actually developing into an ecosystem. And these two authors, basically their careers have been transformed by the fact that they were engaged in publishing an open textbook, so it can help authors too. So there's a growing amount of research out there now that looks at the outcomes of students who use open educational resources compared to traditional textbooks. So, you know, a lot of people will ask about quality, like, you know, how can something that's free and openly licensed be of high enough quality? Because who would take the time to write something if they're not going to get paid for it? Or, you know, how do you even maintain quality control if it's open? But what they've actually found in these studies that look at students versus students using traditional textbooks versus open textbooks is that the outcomes are at least equivalent. And in many cases, they're much higher. And this is one peer-reviewed article in a top journal that looks at a number of different metrics across a number of different campuses. And the one that really stuck out to me is that students who used open textbooks tended to have a significantly higher credit load the next semester after using an open textbook. They put that money that they saved toward taking more courses. And when, you know, we look at graduation rates and time to graduation is an important metric for the success of an institution, this can help. Another area where institutions are looking is concentrating these impacts in degree programs. So in Tidewater, at Tidewater Community College in Virginia, they actually developed a two-year business administration degree that uses OER in every single course, so that students can literally get their degree without spending a single dollar on textbooks. And this was a few years ago. Since then, last summer, a nonprofit called Achieving the Dream announced a 37-campus pilot program where they were going to develop OER degrees at all of those institutions as well. And it's not that each one is developing its own business administration degree. It's that each one is developing a different OER degree program and then sharing those resources so that any other campus can take them and localize them. Now, of course, the idea of a fully OER degree program makes a lot more sense in a two-year context than it does in a four-year context. But, you know, think about the core here, you know, gen ed courses. What if you eliminated textbook costs in all of those, the courses with the highest enrollment, with the largest number of students going through those courses, and often paying the highest amount of money in textbook costs? But the impacts aren't just about finances and economics and measurable outcomes. It's also about expanding what you can do in the classroom. And I want to tell you, the final example I want to give is just a really cool one out of Brigham Young University in Utah. So David Wiley, a professor there, who's a thought leader in the open education movement, was teaching this course called Project Management for Instructional Designers in the College of Education. It's a graduate level course, very high level. But there's no textbook for that course. There's no Project Management for Instructional Design textbook because the market is so small. So rather than trying to piece together, have his students buy 5 different books and read a chapter in each one of them, what he did was actually take an open textbook that was meant for general project management, and he assigned to his students to turn it into project management for instructional design. So, students would go through and critique the material. Is this relevant? Is this not? Can we turn it, take this example about concrete procurement and replace it with an example of digital content procurement, or what have you. And it created this learning environment where students were actively engaged in the content that they were using for the course and created a living and breathing object that the future generations of the course could use. So I defy you to find a book that has a copyright 2017 that was actually created in 2017, a publisher book. This book has copyright 2017. Actually, I'm not totally sure that they've updated, but pretty soon it will be, if it's not already. So it's just a great illustration of the kind of things that are possible when resources are open. And not every instructor wants to do this in their course. But there's smaller ways to engage students with open content. Whether it's writing test questions that can be used in the future for extra credit, or critiquing parts of the textbook. The exercise of evaluating and assessing materials can actually be really useful for helping students understand the content. And you can't do that if you don't have the right to fully use the material. So I want to close by talking a little bit about what you all can do around open educational resources and how you might be able to take some of this back into your daily lives. So Haley mentioned earlier the Rhode Island Open Textbook Initiative that PC is part of. There's a lot of opportunities here working with other schools around the state and seeking ways to share best practices, connect faculty who are in different subjects or similar subjects across institutions, and use this as an opportunity to raise awareness on campus. And see, I bet that Providence College, you can save your students $5 million in 5 years, not just the whole state. So the biggest things that I can recommend are first, just think about it as something to add to your activities. When you can share, do share. And when you can support sharing, do it. Not everybody is going to want to publish an open textbook and spend the time writing one, and that's okay. But are there materials that your faculty here are creating or your library is creating on information literacy that you're not making available openly yet, but you could share and reach a larger audience? Second, thinking about open as the default, as opposed to something that needs to happen overnight. It's about consider using OER before anything else. Not every professor is going to be able to find an open educational resource that they want to use or, want to use one, and that's okay. Find the professors who do want to make a change in their teaching and work with them to give them support. And, it's not too much to ask to at least consider whether there is a low-cost, adaptable resource out there that could actually help ensure all of your students have access to the material on day one of the course and be able to save it forever. So there's a great resource to recommend to faculty called the Open Textbook Library, and you can see the web address there. It's maintained by the University of Minnesota and the Open Textbook Network, and they've collected basically a bunch of open textbooks that are out there and have worked with faculty across the country to vet them. So you can see down here that, recent reviews that they're, star ratings of textbooks here, kind of like Amazon. And the faculty who write these reviews do so on a rubric in a way that it provides really useful information for faculty reading it. Because, you know, quality isn't binary. It's, you know, what might be high quality at CCRI may be low quality here, or vice versa, depending on what the material is appropriate and targeted for. So this is a great resource, a great place to start. It doesn't have a textbook for every single course, but it has textbooks for a lot of courses and can give you a sense of what's out there. And, you know, this idea of making OER the default, if we were able to just switch out one traditional textbook for OER for every student in the country, it would save students $1.42 billion every year. So that's the kind of impact that we're talking about. Third point, thinking about what you can do to give support to faculty. You know, what are the ways you're already interacting with faculty? How can you insert OER into those conversations? And I know that there is a mini grant program here. The example I often point to for impact is the University of Massachusetts Open Education Initiative, which has been giving out mini grants, I believe, for 4 or 5 years, and has saved students well over $1 million through the courses that they've transitioned to OER. And just working with faculty who want to engage with them, and, you know, providing the unique expertise that the library can provide in terms of searching and curating collections of resources that are online, you know, looking into the library catalog in cases where you can't find open educational resources, and assembling a resource that can fully replace a traditional textbook. There are also publishing efforts going on. The Virginia Tech Libraries just partnered with their business schools to publish an open textbook, an intro business open textbook that is now available for, the business school is going to use it, but now it's available for everybody in the country to use. And it's a great opportunity to showcase the excellent scholarship that takes place at their campus on business. And then finally, I just think it's important to think about how open fits in to the mission of every institution. And I took the liberty of pulling up PC's mission. You know, the idea of open fits directly into this, you know, commitment to community pursuit and growth of knowledge, and the idea of your neighbor, sharing what you can share, and being open about what you produce in ways that benefit society. And, you know, I've mentioned that I've visited 200 institutions. I've never found one whose mission did not connect back to openness. So I think just as you walk away, think about, you know, your life, where you are touching educational content, whether it's, you know, is it a librarian working with faculty to find content, or as a faculty member signing materials for your course, as a student who's using resources. Think about where open fits in to what you do, and think about taking at least one small step, whether it's sharing one resource, having one conversation, one thing you can do to make your practice more open. Thank you. Do we have time?
I'm curious about political resistance to that, because if students are saving money, which I think is what we do, somebody may be losing money.
Mm-hmm.
Have you encountered any kind of organized opposition?
So if it's a political question, you know, most of my job actually focuses on policy in Washington, D.C., and absolutely, we've been battling the publishing industry for 10 years, who do view OER as a threat. More recently, the publishing industry has started to do things like Pearson just launched an OER platform where you can, you know, incorporate OER into Pearson materials. But, you know, years ago it was, this stuff is low quality, it's never going to work. And, you know, just dismissing the idea of, you know, free textbooks. It's progressed. But there absolutely is resistance by the status quo, for sure. And I think we're kind of reaching the point just now where they're realizing that this is actually real. You know, the point that the music industry maybe reached when iTunes was coming on board. So on campus, though, you do see certain types of political resistance. I think we all know the rate of change in higher education is slower than outside of higher education. There's a commitment to practices and preserving the way that things are done. So in some ways, this can be seen as a threat, but I think it also is really a great opportunity to expand academic freedom and increase ownership of the academy over the resources we produce. So the academy outsourced the idea of scholarly communication and publishing and all of that in an age where that was actually necessary to print and ship physical representations of knowledge. But in today's world, it's not as necessary. And I think, especially since we can pass around a textbook that's used at hundreds of universities across the country that's open, it helps make this seem less of a huge jump because it's just a textbook. Yes?
What can we say to faculty who earn some prestige, tenure, and promotion, and some royalties about shifting to the free open resources, particularly those who write textbooks and
yeah.
get tenure promotion based on them and
some royalties. Okay, so yeah, let's separate the issues of tenure and promotion and royalties. So in terms of royalties, I have met maybe one professor who has ever been satisfied by the amount of royalties that they've received from their textbook. Their hard work is not compensated to the degree that they wish it would be. And we're not saying that the work they do isn't valuable. It absolutely is. It's that there are more efficient ways to go about supporting it, whether it's through grants. You know, OpenStax provides an upfront payment to faculty that's financed by the partnership arrangements that they have for ancillary products. In some cases, faculty are given awards that they're able to publish with. And Oregon State University has a publishing program where the library works with the press to actually give a budget transfer to the faculty for their work. So there are other ways to do this besides charging $400 for the textbook and shipping back a tiny percentage back to the faculty member. So also talking about tenure and promotion and the value of peer review, you know, once again, there is value in that, and you know, there is value in what publishers do. But you know, we need to make sure that assessing the value of scholarship isn't linked to where it is published necessarily. And I think there are lots of different ways to evaluate the impact of teaching and learning. And a lot of tenure and promotion forums are starting to recognize contributions to teaching. So perhaps there are ways to have open publications and the use of open educational resources enhance careers. Yeah. Oh, yeah. So that's peer reviewed.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
So I know a lot of the framework of this conversation has been about saving students money and saving money, which is key. But we've also been working with the Office of Innovation about what is the opportunity for OER to help diversify materials in the mm-hmm. classroom so that it's not just solely the parameter of what the publisher thinks is important, but the ability to bring in material, whether it be gender, race, socioeconomics, religion. And so we think that that's another intangible that might not be so tied to the finances of it, but does enhance the opportunity for education expansion.
So important. Thank you for sharing that. So other questions or comments? Yes?
I'm particularly curious with the project management for instructional design one, mm-hmm. insofar as there was a sort of student creative element. And I was wondering if there were other examples of that, because I think that's one of the other potentially neat things, the diversification one. But the mm-hmm. opportunity, which I could link to that, for students to be more active as creators of material rather than just passive consumers.
Yeah.
And so I was curious if there are other examples or if that's something that you and your colleagues see as a virtue of OER?
Absolutely. There are many examples of instructors using open educational resources as an opportunity to engage students and have students actually contribute. There's one project at UC Davis in the chemistry department. They maintain a resource called ChemWiki, where it's basically a living textbook about chemistry that students can contribute to and expand throughout the course. In some cases, professors will have students, publish their assignments on blogs and make that contribution to the world visible. Instead of assigning an essay that every student writes the same one that they, probably hate writing and the professor probably hates grading, and then everybody just sort of agrees to throw it all away at the end of the semester, it's a way to actually use the power of students in a classroom to enhance the body of knowledge and representations of knowledge that are out there. So I love that you raised that. Thank you.
I'm just curious to know if the OER movement has experienced any of the pitfalls of some of the publishing industry. In other words, has it stayed true to its roots, or has it, as it's gotten much bigger, sort of become something institutional in of itself? And if there's anything that some of its more like really radical organic supporters would say, this is not what we have. Is there anything going on like that?
I'm guessing you're from the software world.
The
software
world?
A little more so.
Yeah.
Okay, so the reason I ask is that any movement ends up evolving and changing over time. And I would say, so I've been working on these issues for the past 10 years since I was a 21-year-old that just graduated college. So I came into it with a certain perspective, and my perspective has certainly changed over time. I think that there are always, key voices within a movement who help set the overall tone. But I think we have stayed true to our mission around openness, and it's not without the dynamics that exist within any movement about purists versus people who believe that commercial involvement is okay, and different people draw the line in different places. But I would say, having worked 10 years in advocacy and with a lot of different issues and communities, I've never seen another movement with the level of commitment to collaboration and supporting each other and sharing the way that the OER movement is.
I guess I asked because, I feel like I was, I witnessed some of the, I don't really know when it started or where it started, it's probably very organic, but I feel like I did witness a lot of the hacking going on at the beginning of the movement, maybe 10 years ago.
Mm.
And then since then, it seems to have developed a lot of institutional support.
Yes.
And I was just curious, what if there, I think I remember the MacArthur Foundation being really involved, but I'm not sure. But is there like an institution which is kind of like the biggest one at the top of all of them?
So the Hewlett Foundation is the major funder of the movement. The Hewlett Foundation, they've actually funded my work on this issue for 10 years.
Just quickly, I wanted to echo a bit of what you said around the Rhode Island Open Textbook Initiative. I work as the Director of Education for the Rhode Island Office of Innovation. And so,
hey.
We connect via email.
Yes.
But I just wanted to echo that and to say that we really are, as a state, excited about the possibilities for OER at the K-12 level as well as at the higher ed level. And there's as if the PC community is interested in taking this on at a broader and a more robust level, as you guys are running into barriers or seeing need to help communicate across other institutions or connect in with, I'm not going to promise a lot, but connect in with small pockets of funding to support vetting or things like that, please reach out to us. We want this initiative at the state level to be really successful. And so as much as we can support the different institutions that you guys are working to push this forward.
Thank you for sharing that. Highly encourage you guys to work together with the Office of Innovation and the other colleges. How do they get in touch with you?
That's a great question. I don't have any business cards today.
Okay. We'll make sure that gets out.
Yeah, we'll make sure that gets out to everybody.
Perfect.
Thanks everybody for coming. Thank you so much to Nicole for taking the time out to be here. Thanks to so many folks from the library for being here. I will point out that Andrea, Tiemann in the back, and I are going to be working with the faculty who have been awarded the mini grants, and we hope to share some information about that experience in concert with the faculty at the end of that semester. We also have a publication infrastructure built in the library. We have our digital commons and some other systems, so if there are faculty in the room who are interested in creating and publishing OER, we can talk to you about that. Feel free to email me. I will try to kind of collect the names of folks who are here and share out the resources, especially on Danielle's contact info and Nicole's slides. So, thank you.